October 5th, 2017 workshop meeting at the elementary school. We look forward tonight to learning more about this school's plans for the year. So at this time, I would like to get started with the meeting with the Pledge of Allegiance. We'll move right to reports with Superintendent of Schools, Mr. Michael Brooks.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you very much for coming out. I'd like to first note that we have Assemblyman Spartatos here tonight, so thank you so much for coming this evening. The partnership is strong, and we truly appreciate it. Also, our student rep, Isabella, can't be here tonight. She could be here tonight, but the junior-senior girls football game is a pretty important rite of passage for seniors. Plus, more importantly, college financial aid night is tonight, and Isabella is a college-bound student, so it's a pretty important night for her. So I said, I think the board will understand that that's where your priority is tonight. Tonight, you will hear about some very interesting perspectives on performance for this school and plans for the future. Just so the public is aware, this board has adopted an aggressive vision statement and set of goals. Tonight, that board will advance that set of goals with our administration, specifically looking at building a data-savvy Board of Education, review of programs and their efficiency and effectiveness, a transparent approach to how we conduct ourselves publicly. You see that if you look on our website for our board meeting organization through Board Docs. All of the documents for tonight's action items and the presentation are available on that site simply by clicking on those items. We are a results-driven group of people. You will see tonight a group of administrators talking results and driving themselves forward for excellence because of those results. A K-12 focus, so we're starting here at the elementary school, but we certainly finished this school tour in December with a visit at the high school with the same approach. And you also notice STEAM and STEM, science, technology, engineering, and math, woven through much of what we do at all three levels. Notably, our middle school did just receive a STEAM award, science, technology, engineering, and math, from the New York State School Boards Association for the sixth grade program and the summer program on STEAM, something we would love to expand. And certainly, I know that that's something that Assemblyman Spartatos is very proud of as well, because it's an initiative that he's behind. So we're really proud of where we're going, and I think you're going to see us really introspectively as a group of administrators looking at what our programs are doing and what they should be doing. So where are we, and where do we want to get to? That leadership came from this Board of Education as they adopted a vision set and a goal set. Very, very important element. Also, a very exciting thing today. A few of us attended at the high school an event where a group of biology students gathered in the auditorium. It's first experience with this type of a distance learning experience. And the biology teachers had set it up with a researcher from a university in Pennsylvania that is a researcher on the influenza virus, and really dug deep into what that person is doing from a research perspective on how we can combat the influenza virus. And it was just really, truly an amazing experience watching and listening. We're going to stay for a little while, but just seeing our high schoolers engaged with a scientist in his laboratory in Pennsylvania live. Just a wonderful experience. And the two biology teachers that put that together absolutely committed to much more of this on a much smaller and intimate scale going forward. So just some wonderful experiences. The last piece I want to talk about is a teamwork element. I talked about it with my administrative group today. And I asked them, quite provocatively actually, what's the difference between 3% and 1%? And obviously the answer is 2%. But the point I was trying to make is that there's a very small difference between 3% and 1%. But it also depends upon the perspective. Recently, I was with a retired superintendent, been retired for a number of years, was located in the Texas area, and was talking about how he's been doing a lot of corporate work and corporate consulting. And his path to get to that was interesting, but it has nothing to do with the 3% and 1%. Actually, the 3% and 1% teamwork story talks specifically about his open heart surgery. Okay, got my attention. He said I had open heart surgery about 12 years ago. And it went wonderfully. He said, going into it, I was very, very worried. Something wrong with my ticker. I need to fix it, and I need to get the right person to fix it. But in his research, of course, any doctor that he met with, so doc, is this your first time? Please tell me no. I want to know that I've got someone experienced that's doing this very important surgery. And in his research, he found that 97% of heart surgeries, open heart surgery, bypass, successful. It is one of the most successful surgeries done. So that's wonderful, 97%. He said, but you can get to 1%. 1%. He said, so which doctors? Are the 1% doctors? He says, no, it's not about the doctor. Because the research showed that the doctor wasn't the key element in the success. It was the team around the doctor. So there was 97% success regardless of the experience level of the doctor. To get to 99% success, you have a well-oiled machine that works together that has practice with that doctor. 2%, no big deal. There's 500,000 heart surgeries in America, and 2% is 10,000 people. The point I'm making is that this is about a team. And the team that's sitting at this table, the team that's sitting out in this audience, the team that's up in Albany for us, makes all of this do something better. It makes it 1%. So I want to thank the team I work with. You folks are great people. This group of people, great people. For one team focused on being Welcome to Marlboro. Remember that message, people. Welcome to Marlboro. It's a great place to be. We've got great people doing great things for great kids. So that's my last one.
Thank you. Like Mr. Brooks said, we have the very distinct pleasure of welcoming Assemblyman Spartatos to present the Summer Reading Challenge Awards.
You know, I'm not going to use the mic. I'm a loud mouth. I think you can hear me, right?
Yeah.
So, good evening, ladies and gentlemen, parents, students, board members, Madam President, Mr. Superintendent, thank you for this year's participation, 2017 Summer Reading Program. And I am ecstatic to hear about, first of all, congratulations on the award. This was a STEM award, there's also STEAM, by the way, and science, technology, engineering, math. I think we should also include art. That's these are programs, P-TECH, IT, and so on, computer science. These are the things that our kids really can use because they are preparing them for the workforce. So yes, indeed, I am a proponent of teaching our children and getting them ready for work. The fact is that there are a lot of jobs out there, and I speak to a lot of people. And this is one of the biggest things people tell me, and businesses tell me, that children are graduated and they're not ready for the workforce. So technical skills are extremely important. So as far as I'm concerned, congratulations, and whatever I can do, I'm here to do that. Indeed, we are partners in this thing. We're all responsible for the education of our children. As far as the summer reading program is concerned, so children were asked to read for 5 minutes every day for 40 days in the months of July and August. and many people participated. I believe there's about a few of them here today, although many from the Marlboro School District did participate. What I'd like to do is, as I call your name, I would appreciate it if you just came up here to stay, and so we can take a group picture together. So those that, and by the way, we all know the importance of reading, obviously, especially now with smartphones and social media that seems to preoccupy us all. So, and the children were asked to read either alone with a buddy or parents. Of course, getting parents involved is really the most important thing. We know education begins at home. So the children that actually completed this 5 minutes every day for 40 days in the months of July and August were Ellie Kokazi. This seems to be a family affair. Emma Kokazi. Does any of the parents want to participate?
They want to go up there beyond.
Okay, very well. Thank you very much and congratulations.
Moving on to our presentation, at this time I would like to introduce Robin Hecht, Director of Curriculum and Instruction, to begin our academic program review.
Tonight, Dr. Marianne Wilson, so we are very grateful for her. I would just like to say thank you. And as she welcome our new interim assistant principal, Derek Kaplan, who begins with us on Tuesday, but came tonight just to say hello and to participate as part of the team. So thank you, Derek. Mr. Salzano, would you hit the light for us, please?
I got it.
Thanks, sir.
You got it.
So welcome to Marlboro Elementary School. Here at Marlboro Elementary School, we support our Board of Education vision in all that we do. We support our Board of Education's goals in all that we do. Marlboro Elementary School is committed to excellence. We have quality programs which help students excel. And we strike the appropriate balance between providing and expanding student programs as we communicate with our families and all constituents in support of our students. We support a K-12 structure with program options, and we strive for a results-driven measurement system. We help to prepare our students for STEM-related academic. As Mr. Brooks referenced earlier, teamwork is key in our support of students. Our administrative support team is supported by our safe learning environment team, and they are supported by our academic support team. At this time, I would like my faculty and staff who are present to support this presentation to please stand so we can acknowledge and thank you very much for joining us. Today we have 838 students approximately learning in 40 classrooms with us every day. Currently, our fifth grade has our highest population with 153 students. Our kindergarten has 117 students. We have six sections of each grade level, kindergarten through five, and four self-contained classrooms. So this slide speaks to the academic performance based on state assessment results, and we're particularly proud to celebrate the fifth grade ELA and fifth grade math results. You can see that how this is read is the number of students who have attained levels 3 and 4, around 33% in the fifth grade ELA, but levels 2, 3, and 4 is nearly 70%. You'll see then that also fifth grade math shows 48.2%, which is quite outstanding, and then 2, 3, and 4 is 78%. And both of those reflect gains from last year. A real kudos to all those whose work impacts the outcomes of these assessments. And of course, we always love science because it's a great performance outcome, and we're proud of that always. Communication is key, and we are proud that the communication with our families led to reduced opt-outs last year for our assessments. Parents who did send in letters requesting opt-outs received a personal phone call from me. Our teachers were very supportive and made that communication very clear and effective, and we had much more participation in the tests. So we are very grateful for that.
Hi, this slide explains our performance level definitions. As you know, level 4 means that we are performing above grade level. Level 3 puts us at grade level, and what we wanted to highlight tonight is that students performing on level 2 are still considered on track to meet the graduation requirements, although they still need to do some work with their New York State Generation Learning Standards. At this grade, for this year, we're focusing on moving our students from level 1 into level 2.
This side looks at comparison to our neighbors, if you will, in the county. And again, fifth grade ELA and fifth grade math show gains, show higher rankings, and that's certainly to celebrate. And it's important to note that overall, The ranking was in the bottom third, and now it's in the middle third. And that's no small feat for those kinds of improvements to make that happen. So again, kudos to all.
How do we measure student learning? New York State assessments are very important, as you know, but as you can see, we use multiple measures to assess our students, and we get different kinds of data from each of these measures, and they are used to drive instruction and to help move students along as they are growing academically. What do we want our students to know and to be able to do? That's defined by our Next Generation Learning Standards in ELA, Mathematics, Science, Social Studies, Art, Problem Solving, Critical Thinking, and Respect and Responsibility. So that will continue to be our focus this year. So let's talk about how do we teach the curriculum. Let's look at each content area. In math, our focus areas include an academic vocabulary with a focus on content areas. We've just implemented ALEC for math remediation in grade 5. We have started a deep dive with Karen Brooks, who's a data analyst and instructional coach from BOCES. And we have collaboration between general ed and special ed teachers for lesson development as well as instruction. In ELA, again, academic vocabulary with a focus on content areas. We do have a word of the week that we are appreciative to Ms. Casey for. We have questioning techniques, increased critical thinking skills and abilities, guided reading and balanced literacy approach with Dr. Marianne Riley, who's a literacy consultant. This is her second year with professional development with our teachers. We are implementing Orton-Gillingham multisensory approach for our ENL, special ed, and AIS teachers. That professional development is ongoing. It started last week and it continues through the spring. And we have strategies that we are learning to support struggling writers with William Van Cleve, a literacy consultant. Our collaboration again between general ed and special ed teachers for lesson development with Fontes and Pinnell is ongoing, but we are very fortunate that Mrs. Kaplan's strength is in this particular area and she is an expert in her field, and we are pleased to have her join us and to bring that expertise to our faculty and staff and students. In science, again, an academic vocabulary with a focus on the content areas. We have newly developed units, thanks to our teachers participating in BOCES to produce these. We have technology-infused lessons, OzoBots, and 3D printing. Skype a scientist in grade 5. And students are conducting investigations, solving problems, and engaging in discussions. In social studies, our students are developing the ability to make informed and reasoned decisions for the public good. They are evaluating sources and using evidence, and they are strengthening their questioning techniques, increasing their critical thinking skills and abilities, all of these building lifelong skills.
So that's the focus on what we teach, but this is the focus on who we teach and who teaches. With that in mind, these are certainly photos and reminders of who I will miss the most, including the students and those who support them. Yeah. Because every day you support the whole child with a lot of different initiatives. Some to highlight include teamwork, nutrition and wellness program, parent communication. What's coming up next is with the addition of the additional social workers, there will be some lunchtime social groups forming. And thanks to Mrs. Kaplan, who's joining us with an expertise in PBIS, she'll also be able to help put some of those initiatives in even clearer format, and that will be a plus. So I thank all of you for this opportunity to share MBS in the community. Thank you.
Yes, I have a question. On the page that you show the other areas where you do student learning, STAR, ESGI, ESPARC, all of this, are there any plans this year to develop some measurement reports or systems that we're going to see throughout the year to show how you're doing and how you measure your own progress, in addition to what we see in the annual state assessment?
Are you asking if we keep records?
No, I know you obviously keep records. This long list here obviously supports what the point was. But is there going to be any effort to try to communicate to the community and to the board some kind of a measuring system or a trending analysis or something that really further demonstrates that you're being successful, or if you have some problem areas, what you're doing to respond to that throughout the year?
Right now, from the current list, state assessments are the only things that are communicated publicly, but it is a great idea. We should look at a way to reflect that and to show our growth. It could be an item for discussion, something we can come back to. We presently do that in-house, and what you saw was Karen Brooks is working with the teachers with data analysis and began that with opening day. So I think that we need to first work with our own in-house use of the data. And then it is available to parents through Parent Portal and through parent-teacher conferences and such. But I think you're looking for something broader, and that's something we don't have at this present time.
Yeah, as I've communicated long, even before I was a board member, I'm not a big fan of the state assessment data. Not by any fault of the school district or any school district, but when you have an average of 10 to 40% opt-out rate across districts, our own was between 10 to 25, and you start comparing school to school, district to district, you're missing a lot of data. And then you have all the other variables with the state tests, such as content changing and baselines changing and standards changing. While it's certainly a good, obviously a good point of data to study, and percentage proficiency is a good one, that says that of the ones who took the test, where people sit. But when you start comparing to school districts and even within the school itself, there's, to my, in my opinion, there's so many variables that it loses its value. So, and it's a year old. We're looking at data from last year's fifth grade class that's now in sixth grade, and you know, go down the line, fourth grade's in fifth grade. So ideally, there'd be something of which the each school would have a different set, but there'd be some set of measurements that says, of all these other things we do in-house, what could we show the community and the board that says we are making progress, our programs are working, our investments in staff and technology are working, making a difference, and here's how we show it to you. And I personally believe you are doing that already internally and not giving yourself enough credit, quite frankly.
One measure, I don't know why I can't find the page, but one measure that is universal across the district, especially in the K-8, K-9 world, for the STAR assessments. However, the caution on that is that STAR assessments are a diagnostic tool that are used and normed, and nationally normed, so it's an easy way to also balance yourself or compare yourself to a larger subset, a larger group, as you're looking from a national perspective. The caution on that, though, is that it is primarily for a diagnostic purpose, and it's a quick probe. So the reading test and the math test are going to be anywhere from 20 to 30 minutes for each of the tests, depending upon the grade level. Then we have STAR Early Literacy also that deals with pre-readers, students that are emergent readers. So those are certainly measures that can be looked at from a aggregate perspective where we can say, well, how did they do? But we still need to compare it to something. So there is a report inside STAR that does compare it as if it was a New York State test. So there are some predictors in there. The caution on that is that it's not the state test. It's not a comprehensive test. Like I said, it's only a 20 to 30 minute probe. The value of assessment like STAR or any of the others, Fountas and Pinnell, is it really digs into the depth of what that specific child needs. So it's a diagnostic tool for the classroom, for AIS teachers, for special education teachers. So that's really the power of those kind of tools. So to look at it from a perspective of, are there probes and measures that we can use on a quarterly or semesterly basis to give a progress report? Potentially, but I think we really need to spend some time administratively deciding what are the appropriate ones that we would report out on as the measure. And I don't know, as we sit here in October of 2016, that those tests exist. Well, whether to purchase them or create them. And there's two big leaps there that are important leaps.
And I want to make sure, because when I brought this up, I think it's been understood differently. I don't think any of that in-house data can be compared to other districts, right? As you just suggested.
Well, the STAR is nationally normed, but we just can't compare it directly to another right. district. So if you fall in the 72nd percentile, you're performing better than 70% of the other test takers that took STAR nationally.
So I'm thinking of things like the percentage of children that are moving from twos to threes and threes to four.
But the only measure that uses that number, state test.
And again, I don't want to specify the numbers, but you all have, you're the experts. You know how to measure, and you're doing it now. You're doing it as you describe in this page, with 10 different things here at least. So all I'm saying is I would think it would behoove the school district, and in support of the Board of Education goal, for each school to come up with some set, independent of the state assessment, that says this is how we feel, these are data, this is data that we feel that shows we're doing what we want to do, or where we need some work, or where we need some investment, whatever the case may be. I would never be the one to try to suggest it. Not my expertise, but I just think it's been one of my pet peeves for a while. And I have two children. The last one's going to elementary school right now. I've seen the progress. I've seen how you've latched on and supported Common Core before it was even a mandate. And I think there's more value that the school district can demonstrate than that can be demonstrated with only state assessment. That's really where I'm not even trying to suggest that you're not. That there's a problem. That's really my point.
Of all those tests that we have listed there, how many of those are given to everybody?
Like I said, STAR is pretty much the only universal one, and that's for reading and for math.
So the only, and that's only
nine-ish, definitely K-8, some ninth graders also.
But and it's only given during,
Robin, is that three or four times a year? Three times a year.
So, really the only thing that would be quarterly or semi-annual or something like that would be report card rates.
Report card rates, correct.
We could do an aggregate of where a group is going from one to the other, and if you have this year's sixth grade, you'll see how they're doing in seventh grade next year as an aggregate, because it's something that comes out quarterly that takes into account all kinds.
Yes, it's just not an objective measure. Well, yes, that's that. But yes, that is a quantifiable number that we could use to gauge some level of progress. But it's not necessarily progress towards a state standard. It's not necessarily. So that's.
But that's only an annual thing. For what John's talking about, to be able to see something. Mm-hmm. You know, obviously you have individual children, but then you have an overall average.
Yep. We can continue looking at this. This is there will be a new adventure for us to figure out what is that measure. And with integrity, say to you, I'm ready to. This is a board's discussion there. So, the important piece here is that I need to be able to be comfortable coming to the board in the public that this number that we put on that screen, that's the measure, has integrity to it. And I'm just saying that as we sit here in October 2017, that measure doesn't exist. That doesn't mean that we haven't had extensive dialogue about what that measurement should be. It's just coming to, no problem, let's calculate it and put it out there. We'll continue. We're going to continue trying to find that number. But I don't want to just put something out just to, okay, here we did. That's not what I did. I mean, we put something out with true integrity that means something. So I'll be honest with you. Right now, that number doesn't exist.
Okay. Well, to my original question,
it's not because we don't want it to exist, but because
it's difficult. Right.
Well, no. The number, we'd only be able to produce right now a number for reading and math. Those aren't the only important subjects. We won't be able to produce a number at all for social studies, for science.
Well, that's why I think
for music, right? You know what I mean? So
at the high school level, you get GPAs. At the middle school, you have other grading systems that you could do by grade. Right. I would think whether or not, and maybe it's a test that we use, is you take those quarterlies and your annual year, and then see, okay, we went from here to here, what did we do that same year in the state test?
Right.
I mean, the worst we can say is, yeah, this system really doesn't tell us anything.
Right.
But it's also not creating something new.
Right.
It's using data we have and having somebody, there's got to be a way to pull it out of the system.
See what we can do.
Yeah. Yeah. Without having to create new work.
It's all in the computer. Take your quarterly grades. It's all in the computer. We should be able to figure out a way with our regional information center to identify which numbers we want to hold an average. We should be able to do that. It's identifying them and saying that they have integrity. Yes. Yeah.
Also, Frank did come up with a good idea, but it also would be like, maybe Frank hit on something before John, also following the group of like the fifth grade that went to the sixth grade, and to see if they've come up, and to see if they're gaining. Is there a way to do that also?
I just want to remind, the answer is yes, but I just want to remind everyone here, this is the work that's done all day long, every single day by the staff. And look, what we're trying to find for this group of leaders here is to find some bottom line aggregates. So digging into item analysis and which specific skill sets are the children having difficulty with because of what they demonstrated on any one of those subset tests, that's what drives instruction. What we're looking for is some evidence, I think what I'm hearing, some evidence that shows that we're making progress in our investment. And while I fully respect the perspective on the state tests as a district official and a required state ed person, the state tests are the state tests, and they are the things by which we are measured. That is where our report card comes from. That is what we have to produce as the thing that says we met the standard or we didn't. So we do have to keep a focus on that piece. Irrespective of that, we also will look to find what numbers can we produce to show progress, or not. Not progress.
Great. That was the original question. Are you going to be working on that?
We are. Yeah, we are. As I said, as I sit here on October of 2017, don't have that number set.
Certainly,
I should have pulled out any set of numbers, but I would have been putting something up that's just.
I know
check
you would never do that. Not do any of it. Your staff, but I'm confident that if the staff puts their mind to it and focuses on this, that you'll find a set of parameters. Not going to be perfect. There's going to be some qualitative measures in there because we're dealing with people and students and different environments and everything else. But all those factors go into the state test as well. It might be a quantitative measurement and the only one, but it has its issues as well. So what you come up with, in my opinion, will never be any worse. It can only be better.
I hope so.
Yeah, I know.
So one day long here, I do want to thank everybody, the staff and everything, for all their hard work that they've done, you know, with the kids and everything. It's something that we don't always know. So while you're all sitting here, thank you for all your hard work with all the students.
Regarding the success of all children, I was wondering if there were any specific populations that you have concerns about this year.
The population that we have concerns about in particular, and it's not just us, it's a pervasive thing, are our children of poverty. So it's hard to believe that we have that here, but we do. And we have children we have homeless children. We have 37% free and reduced lunch rate in the district. And that's the population that is a big concern. As all students are concerned, obviously, we are targeting all populations, but that is a major focus as well.
In regards to that population, do you have is it attendance? Is it multiple things that become challenges every day?
It's multiple things. We're very fortunate that we
are able to keep a close eye on the students. Attendance is often a problem, but we're able to, if they are homeless, we are obliged to transport, so we're able to get them here, obviously. Hopefully the parents are utilizing our bus system. If there's any kind of an attendance problem, we call, the classroom teacher calls, the nurse calls, we have an attendance committee that meets monthly to track that data. And that is one method that we are using, but we have other things in place, the backpack program to ensure that they have food, extra help that the teachers provide of their own volition for reading and math and support for things like that. Any kind of support that we can give them, anything we can give them, sending books home in Ziploc bags, things like that. Anything you can pick up, Mrs. Tech? You got it.
Also, too, as important as academic success is, I know that from a social development standpoint of view at this level, the elementary school level, you know how passionate this board has been about free play, and I was just wondering where you are within the new guidelines of free play or unstructured play during recess and how you've seen benefits from that.
We have been able to implement it from day one, thank you to the charge that you gave us. And we've been able to do that through the efforts of our teachers, because when we tried to do it through increased lunch recess aid support, it didn't work out with our teaming model for fourth and fifth grade time-wise. It wouldn't have worked out. So our teachers are picking up the extra time as recess, and they're piggybacking it on the already existing time. So if the children were to go out at 12 o'clock and start the recess, the teachers are going out 10 minutes early, and they're starting a recess with them to build in that time and not waste it in transitioning. They're just getting that time to actually extend the play. So that is a shout out to them, and kudos. We very much appreciate that. I don't know, except that the kids are always happy. I don't know that I can speak to the actual benefits, but maybe does one of the teachers care to field that question? Anyone seeing improved behavior, better concentration in the afternoon, anything?
I think the students are happier. They're getting more play time, and I know we just all been happier about it because there's time, especially with the little ones, it takes them so long to get out there to begin with. So it's nice having that extra amount of time to let them just play and, you know, be kids, and I think it's been helpful.
Thank you so much, Ms. Emmerdale. Anyone else?
I think it's also provided us an interesting opportunity to see who's playing by themselves and who's playing with others, and to be able to identify those kinds of social aspects that maybe we aren't seeing in the classroom, especially in the fifth grade level, because we departmentalize. Our kids are constantly moving, but having our time on the playground gives us a little bit of insight as to maybe what's happening on a different level for them. And so for me, that's been helpful to be able to help those particular kids to find friends, and just even going up and saying, oh, let me introduce you to a few children. I think that's beneficial.
Great, thank you. So thank you to the board for advocating for that. Thank you to my teachers for making sure that we implemented this in good faith as charged by the board and our superintendent.
Before you play that too, I want to address a question that Ms. Wharton actually asked a great question there. And this summer we had a administrative retreat where we started looking at data, started looking at numbers. It was state data, sorry, but it does give us that important snapshot. And I challenged our administrative team to look very closely, and it is one of the core reasons why, not the meeting from August, but certainly the foundation was laid prior to that. One of the core reasons why we brought Karen Brooks in, who's a data specialist that works out of Orange El Cervosis. She's really helping us pull out the information that's in the subset data so we can fine tune what are the performance areas, what are the specific skills that are our students are specifically struggling with. Yes, it is the children that didn't opt out, but it still does give us a good snapshot. In particular, I pointed our principals to two specific groups in the K-8 world that appear to be struggling the most. And those two subset groups are those economically disadvantaged children and our special education children. So those are two areas that we have a long-term look at, really spending time focusing on why are those two subsets performing poorly in Marlboro. It's easy for us to turn and say, well, those are the two subsets, because it's true, that perform poorly in McHudson, in Orange Ulster, in Ulster, in New York State, in the United States, because it's true. Those numbers will bear out regardless of the study that we look at. But our focus is our kids. So the charge is look at where our children are performing and help them advance in any way possible each day. If you can make small advancements each and every single day, at the end of the day, it doesn't matter which test. That's why, I'll say it again, we focus on making sure that our curriculum maps show the right things. Are we teaching the right things, regardless of the standard set that's given to us by the state? Are they the right things for first grade? Are they the right things for chemistry? Are they the right things for art? Make sure we're teaching the right things. And then second to that is, are we teaching the right things well? If we are focusing every single day on teaching the right things at each and every grade level, and our professionals know what those right things are, and we're focusing on teaching well. So in order to teach well, you need the tools, you need the stamina yourself, and you also need the information. Where are our children having the most difficulty? Are they having the most difficulty with fractions? Of course, anybody teaches fractions says, yes, they hate fractions, they're terrible with them. Well, what are we doing to focus our energies in those areas? So that's how fine-tuned our approach is on a daily basis. I can honestly say it's not easy work. I know that every single person in this room that's a teacher and that's not here that's a teacher is saying data work is just so time-consuming and takes away from my craft of working, but and when you really look at it, you know that it does help to reform things in the right directions. We also correct our own tests. I know that there are people looking at me right now saying, please contract those tests out. That is such a difficult process. I get that. But believe it or not, that process of correcting those tests is much more valuable than any set of data charts that you're ever going to get from any company. Because the data charts are going to come in a binder this thick. You're going to have googly eyes as you're looking through it. But when you're correcting the test yourself and you're reading the answers that the children write, and you are coming through the pages and looking at the questions, and you develop trends in your mind of, wow, they're really struggling with this concept, that concept, you walk out with an innate sense of things that you need to make adjustments to. That is absolutely something that is one of the most important experiences that this group of teachers will benefit from in the long run, which then makes our children benefit from. So, sorry teachers, we're not contracting out. It is important work. It is also very hard work. I appreciate the work you're doing, but it is probably one of the most important experiences when you look at the grand scheme of things. Yes, it is the state tests, but it is important because it's a comprehensive test. It's not just a quick probe. It's a very comprehensive set of tests. So I hope that helps to round out the perspective, not just from the building view, but that speech that I just gave is the K-12 view that we look at from every single, I don't care if it's physics, or if it's the our entry-level kindergarten test in the summer. That's the view.
So I have one other suggestion based on my own experience as far as that could potentially help the grades, the state test grades, and maybe overall grades. And that is about 3-4 years ago, probably more like 4 years ago, elementary school did a workshop, a Common Core workshop for parents. And I had children first and third grade at the time, and I was struggling helping them with math because I would look at the Common Core documentation and I would have to figure out what a number bond is and a tape diagram is and an area map and all things that I never learned in my long education of math as a computer science and engineering major. And it was struggling, and that one night where he paraded people through 5 different grade levels explaining how it worked and handing out sheets of paper and so forth, it just turned everything around. For me personally, now I can actually help my child rather than actually argue with him sometimes whether he was doing it right or not, and he was right and I was wrong sometimes.
So I'd like to suggest that you might bring those back. I mean, I think one of the ways to help get the grades up and get the understanding is help the parents to help the children. Math in particular, I know ELA is a little different, but math is very prescriptive, right? You follow the engagement York, you follow the modules, the exit tickets, the problem sets. When you get used to that pattern, you can actually really help your child, and you know exactly where they are. By the way, Common Core is that one, which I've learned to like it, actually. But I would just like to suggest if you could bring that back maybe on an annual basis. That might really help overall, you know, get the kids some better help at home when there's parents that really just don't get it themselves.
It's a good idea. We've got some ideas that are actually in the works, so.
It worked. I can tell you it worked. All the parents I talked to and myself really came out of that saying, wow, thank you.
Well, I felt dumb afterwards, I gotta tell you. My daughter was older at that point, but we got all done, I went, and the kids are doing those cards quick. I'm like,
I mean, without belaboring it too much, I think one of the approaches that we are truly looking at things from is teaching the right things regardless of the standard set. Because if you teach reading, it doesn't matter the standards that are put at you and the test that it puts you because you know the reading skill. If you teach earth science, it doesn't matter the test. You teach all the concepts of the science. Because as New York State does, the state just rolled out a new set of standards, and there will be a period of time this year where there's some crosswalking to show us as a school system where are the Common Core standards and where are the next gen standards and how do they crosswalk. So we're going to be in a little bit of a period of flux. But if we focus on what are the right skills that need to be taught regardless of the standard set, we'll be able to meet any standard. That's really what it comes down to. So it's going to be an interesting crosswalk for some time. Robin, did I get that?
Yes,
you
did. And it will be a lot slower than it was the first time. So over the next 2 to 3 years.
Great idea.
I have one more question. In regards to the children of poverty that you speak of, and of course not to get into the micromanaging of the district by any means, but I was just curious with the new implementation of the social worker and just knowing most likely some of the challenges that are going on at home with the family unit and the structure, do we have the ability to provide a bridging program between, I mean, I know we do this every day with communication, but more of perhaps a home visiting program with specific children?
We haven't come across that yet, Mrs. Horton. Obviously, we've done that in the past, and that is something that we could look to do. We have parents in. We provide a lot of resources for the parents and families. Having the additional social worker has been able to give us a focus on K-2 and a focus on 3-5, so teachers know who their point person is and they can reach out. Mrs. Bogacek spoke about seeing children that are on their own sometimes at the playground, and sometimes it's just who they are. They're more introverted perhaps, or just not that outgoing. The social workers have been charged with participating in lunch and recess in an informal way to have social settings and social groups informally and to draw in those children. So we're hoping to have more eyes on them, on the children at all times, and to support as best we can. If we know something specifically, we absolutely address it immediately. We're preparing a letter already to go out. I know that the social workers have drafted it district-wide, I believe, to go out asking parents who feels that they are in need of support for food for Thanksgiving and as well as the holiday time. So there's an application for them with the understanding that, you know, not every need can be met, but we're going to do our best. And this was actually, again, class, and I'm sure other teachers as well last year, adopted families for the holidays and did support in that manner. So it taught the students in the class about the spirit of volunteerism and being a community member, as well as to get that gift when we give back.
Okay, any further questions?
Thank you very much. Before we conclude, I just want to thank my teachers again, once again. If you look around the room, they spent a lot of time with their students. decorating, taking time. You can see it starts with kindergarten, that beautiful What the World Needs Now bulletin board is fifth grade. It moves all the way around and ends here in second grade with, well, we teach our students all about life. Our students teach us what life is all about. That's second grade teachers. So if you have a moment afterwards and you'd like to peruse the room, do a walkabout, that would be enjoyable for you. I know you get a lot out of it. So I want to thank them for that effort and for being here. I want to thank our custodians for preparing the room and preparing everything, keeping us on task every day. And I want to thank Mrs. Salter, who made a beautiful video for us that we're going to share with you in closing. Thank you for the time and your attention. Have a great night. Come back to MES.
Thank you. We are, thank you so much, everyone. We are thrilled to be here today, and we wish you the most success in the year ahead in all of these factors, academics, socially, teaching, growth, perspective. So thanks again for your time, and please feel free if you have kids to get home, or you just have to get home and get to bed yourself, because you have kids to take care of tomorrow in classrooms. please feel free to go ahead and go. But you're more than welcome to stay. Our meetings are very exciting. The attendance is wonderful. So please, take a chance. Thank you, and thank you.
Good night, guys. Good night. I wasn't trying to sleep. She saved us.
That.
Completing our report section of the agenda, we will conclude with Ms. Reed and Vice President Malazzo. Ms. Reed, do you have anything to report from Orange Ulster Voices?
Last night we still have a meeting, and Orange Ulster Voices received a grant, and it's using the Mutual Bento Homeless Adventure Act. What happens is we actually participate into this. Robin's going to explain a little bit more how it works with the books that the kids get, correct, Robin?
Yeah.
If not, I can.
Okay.
Thank you. So we have a lunch buddy group where there is a instructor who comes and meets with a large group of our students who are temporarily housed. Of course, people do not know that they're temporarily housed, but they are allowed to bring, we made an extension, they're allowed to bring a friend.
Good.
So they have lunch, they read books, they participate in bibliotherapy, which is a reading of material that will help them deal with problems, but it also teaches their friends that there are people that have difficulties in the world and gives them strategies how to help. So they're building friendships, and then it happens every week for about 6 weeks. And this year we are going to do it 3 times, and we're doing it right now at the elementary school. We did it last year as well, and it was very successful. It ended up at the end of the sessions. They gave the kids all the books so they could take all those books home, and it was very nice.
It's a wonderful thing to see, because, and I am very proud, because when they put all the names up on the board last night, we were part of it. There are other school districts in Orange, Ulster County that have not participated, but when I saw Marvel, I was like, yes, this is what it's about. It's about our students. It helps those students. They get to bring up a poem, they get to read it. It was very exciting last night when they were talking about it. The other thing that happened last night, which I'm gonna switch places now, is we talked about the conference and the resolution. So please, if you haven't read the resolutions, if there is anything in there that you want to do yes or no, please let me know. And on Wednesday, other than that, that was the end of our meeting.
Our meeting is not till the 26th.
Okay, we have a little bit of a change in the order here. We are going to go to actually number 5, which should be placed up where I'm going now, which is public comment on agenda items. Okay, moving back to 3, the consent agenda. Resolved that the Board of Education, upon the recommendation of the Superintendent of Schools, approve the personnel actions, CSE, CPSE report, and the unofficial board minutes from August 24th, 2017, as presented. Can I get a motion to approve consent reports? Joanne, Frank, second. Any discussion?
I have
one. Actually, I have the institutions, I know that they are the typist and the counter. You have them on step two. There's no salary posted on the step two.
Yeah, it's probably information that we should have taken off the chart altogether because they're not new appointments. They're moving from probationary status to the permanent status, so it's not a, it's like they're getting tenure.
Right, that's why I'm a little confused because once we've appointed them, I mean, the probation was up to you. I mean, we've already approved them.
No, you need to approve that they get permanent status. Right.
Probation.
But the salary and step that we should have taken off. There's no, they're not new appointments. It's just changing
the
status.
But I mean, we're hiring them normally to do the salary this way.
Not hiring them. They're going from probation to permanent status.
Right, but if we're going to permanent, we should still have salary with it. To say, this is what we're now continuing with them, and that's where their step is.
It's no big deal right now.
That's not,
right. It's not that.
I'm just saying for the future, maybe we can, you know, when we do it, because we have done that in the past this way, you know.
We don't do that for, okay. We can look ahead and do that.
You know. My other one was, it says, as needed, Dr. Wilson, is that for a short time, is it for years, is it for 6 months?
Consider it a substitute. So I'm anticipating a potential for a administrative leave coming. So when that does happen, she would fill in for that leave. So you'll approve the leave, and then she would fill in for that leave. I just haven't gotten the paperwork to ask the board to approve that leave yet. So that's what that purpose is. It's so we can immediately plug her into that spot. There also may be the occasion here and there where we could use her for other professional purposes that would be great.
Okay, and is that for the year,
or
is it for now on, because it doesn't say, so I get a little, you know, when we're sitting there, I mean, especially like, you know, when you're calling in for an administrator, let's say somebody calls in sick, or you're going to have them come in.
No, as I said, we have an anticipated leave coming.
It doesn't say that, and it just looks like we're just going to hire someone for, you know, $600 a day, and you have it underneath the administrator, so.
Yes.
Right. It's you know.
It's like we're approving a substitute administrator to use within the budget constraints that you have.
Kind of, but we will have. I can't speak more about it because there's a personnel matter that
it's like approving like the substitute.
Like a substitute.
It's just not the administrator stuff.
Correct. However, we're not going to use it for a per diem substitute. So if administrator is out for a day, we're not going to hire Mary Ann for the day. That's not what we're looking at doing here. This is for an anticipated leave that's coming.
Or if someone's out for 2 weeks or something.
No. Just for this one leave that's coming.
Or as you need her for other specific
projects. Correct. Right. There might be some specific projects like consultancy work or mentoring or things like that. Might be. And this sets up the allowance for that.
I mean, what did we do before? I mean, if we're going to hire a consultant,
hire a consultant
that before, I get a little nervous. I mean,
can I assure you that we hire consultants all the time? We spoke about one today extensively, Karen Brooks, and she sends us a bill and we pay that bill. That's how we do our business on a daily basis. So this is very similar, however, different because this would be specifically plugging in for an administrative leave that's coming.
Plus it sets a rate, whereas the consultants give us a charge of what they're going to bill us.
Correct.
And we accept it or don't.
Correct.
Okay.
Correct. Much
and we
less
don't
than a consultant.
And the
right.
Karen Bruce came out of Bosis that we contracted with Bosis for.
Correct.
Well, we don't
ever. We do. Through Bosis. That's a lot more than $600 a day.
But that's for a specific skill set.
Correct. I mean, you look at some consultancies that are out there that we don't contract that are $4,000 or $5,000 a day. Oh,
something's
got
more.
Come on, Ralph. There are some educational consultants out there that have ridiculous fees, $6,000 a day just for their work. They're ridiculous money.
Any further discussion? We're working. We're on.
Yeah. It worked. Oh, we did. Okay. Oh, so you got it going.
Okay, cast your vote.
We're going to go low tech.
We're high tech. We're low tech. Would you like Teresa to vote for you?
Yes.
Motion has been carried 5-0. Okay, moving on to number 4, recommended actions. Resolved that the Board of Education, upon the recommendation of the Superintendent of Schools, approve the application from Orange County Office of Real Property Tax Service for corrected tax rolls for 2017 for the following properties as presented. Can I get a motion to approve the application from Orange County Office of Real Property Tax Service? Motion to approve. Frank, could I get a second? Russell, any discussion?
Pat, did they give an explanation of how the application is signed on the 13th by the applicant, by the town, and by the county all on the same day?
We're meeting with them tomorrow morning, so we'll
find out what that question is, but they have not said anything about that.
Patrick, would you like to provide any further explanation regarding this?
We have a tax discrepancy notice that was provided to us by the town of Newburgh for the Roseland power plant. It's a major, significant discrepancy, so we're meeting with town of Newburgh officials and county officials tomorrow to review this to find out what happened at the assessing entity, and what are they going to do to resolve this matter. We still have to send a revised bill, so we've been advised to have the board approve that tonight. So
until we send the revised bill, they continue. Like once this is approved, they will then, I believe, have 8 days after our approval, or interest-free for them to be able to make payment. Even though we're into October, that continues since they've not been provided with the correct bill yet. So they'll have a period of time to make payment.
So if we don't approve it tonight, the problem is they can sit till the next meeting plus 8 days,
right,
before interest is due.
We will have to approve it at some point, and they will continue to sit interest-free until we approve it, and then they will have a period of time after we approve it to make payment on it. The reality is it's not their fault that the error occurred.
Yeah, but I think the other thing, we haven't explained what the error is yet.
We've not. Would you like me to?
I think we should.
Yes.
There's not a lot of people here, but Mark can write about it.
All right. So what happened is we received this correction of an error. Roseland has a court-ordered devaluation schedule. So through the bankruptcy proceedings and the sale of the properties, the Roseland facility had a federal court give a determination that over a period of time, their assessed value is going to reduce by a set schedule. The Orange County Real Property and the town of Newburgh are responsible for setting the tax rolls. The assessor in Newburgh is actually an Orange County Real Property employee. The assessor who was there previously has left the job, and they contracted with the county to fill that role. They they forgot to make the change on the assessment based on the court schedule. So they improperly held the assessment at the same value it was last year, and the assessment should have been reduced by about $15 million in taxable assessed value, which is about $43 million in true value. So because of that error, we set our tax levy and sent our tax bills out based on incorrect data, because the county and the town provide us with the overall valuation of the properties within the school district that are located in the town of Newburgh, town of Marlborough, town of Plattekill, Orange County gives Newburgh, Ulster County gives Plattekill and Marlborough. But we use the information that was sent to us. I did question them because it seemed odd to me. I was expecting to see a reduction. So I questioned them on whether or not they had removed the taxable value of Dan Scammer, because Dan Scammer's taxable assessed value was $15.5 million. The reduction in Roseman was $15 million. So when I saw the number come in, you know, I got projections on what I would in theory expect to be. Now, those obviously don't account for growth or new business or change in assessment, but it's a ballpark estimate of where we should be. So the numbers, when I got the numbers from Newburgh, it was very close to what it was last year. And so I, in my head, you know, I would never think that they're just forgetting to change the assessment on Roseman, which is well-defined. I'm saying, look, have you pulled out, because they have to go in and zero out the assessment on Roseman, essentially, or Dan Scammer, to give me the value.
For the pilot.
Right, because of the pilot agreement. So I was questioning whether or not she had made the adjustment to Dan Scammer, because I didn't see the change in numbers that I expected to see. She assured me that she was okay with Dan Scammer, so then I had to attribute that. We talked about it when we set the levy, and we talked about what the tax impact was going to be. My assumption was that we had enough, there was enough growth in the town of Newburgh that it made up for that drop in assessment in Roseman. That's the only logical explanation left.
They had it from the year before. We didn't get hit when we dropped off large
council.
So that wouldn't send a flag.
Right.
So.
It's the only logical explanation, other than we didn't change the assessment like we should have. So the unfortunate piece of all this is that we set our levy and we did our apportionment and we issued our tax rates based on erroneous information, not through no fault of our own. What ultimately is going to result in us being about $1.2 million short in our tax collection. So that's a huge hit for us to take, because you know, that's essentially, you know, $1.2 million that we have to come up with to fund operations for the 17th school year. So just throwing numbers out, if we were going to, if our levy was going to be $34 million, that we expected to collect through taxation, we're now going to get $32.8 million. And we have to fill that hole. So we'll talk about in subsequent meetings what our plan is going to be, but that's the gist of what this resolution is taking care of tonight.
Had it come off, would it change the breakdown by municipality?
Yes. The apportionment.
The apportionment by?
It would.
Okay, I know we have a meeting, but do we have those? Have we looked at those numbers?
I've looked at them quickly to see what it would be. I don't know what they are off the top of my head. Basically, what happened is, you know, we had a reduction in our levy for the third year in a row. This year, we actually saw an expected reduction in tax bills, which was the first that would have occurred for us. Previous 2 years, when we had the reductions in the levy, the drop in value of the power plants have offset that beyond what our levy drop was. So even though we're collecting less money and taxing for less money, the homeowners were still seeing their bill increase slightly to make up for the loss in value, specifically Roseman. So this year, what should have happened is, for reference point, a $300,000 assessed value home, that homeowner this year is seeing about a $200 decrease in their tax bill, when in reality they should have seen about a $100 increase. So taxes, even though we had our levy drop, the tax rate should have increased by 1%. And we saw a reduction in the tax rate, I believe it was like 1.6%, I don't remember the number off the top of my head. This will be corrected next year. Right. It'll be corrected for us revenue.
You don't want the $300 back that I got extra this year plus that.
Correct. The only good part, the drop in value for Roseden from last year to this year was $15 million taxable assessed. Next year is 3.3 and change, 3 point something. So you're going to make up for the loss this year of the $15 million taxable assessed, but it's not like it's tacking on to another $15 million drop. Next year, it's only 3 point something.
To be clear also, tomorrow begins our process to figure how we recoup that in the current year. So we're meeting with county officials and town of Newburg officials to begin finding out how they're gonna rectify it. That's our tack tomorrow, beginning tomorrow. So this is not a fait accompli at this point.
I just think if we can have a rough number for that, and I know it's late in the game, but is rough number percentage wise.
I'll be able to pull it up right here. I'll bring my laptop.
Who benefited the most by it not happening this year?
Well, I can tell you right now that the value of Newburg was overstated. So Newburg picked up a larger portion of the apportionment than they would have otherwise.
So it worked negatively.
To Newburg, other than it worked negative on the apportionment, correct.
But the overall
tax bill, they still benefited. Essentially, what happened is we're taking right now as it stands until we have a resolution, or if we have a resolution, we've essentially given back $1.2 million to all the taxpayers in the district. This is the net effect of what happened here, because we were expecting to raise $34 million, but instead only get $32.8 million, so $1.2 million was remaining in the pockets of the collecting taxpayers rather than paying to us.
We'll get it
But we'll never get it back.
Oh no, that's not
right. Unless we can come to, right now there doesn't appear to be any statutory method of recovery, but we're going to explore what other avenues may be available to us. It's a big.
I'd get fired if I made $1.2 million.
We're fortunate in that we've got healthy reserves and fund balance. And, one of the factors that we will discuss going forward is, we did have $500,000 we were planning to put into a capital reserve account.
It's
probably not going to be my recommendation that we do that if we can't recover this $1.2 million. We're going to use that to offset that. So there are some mitigating factors, but nothing makes it right. And it's still a huge, huge mistake.
As it's noted in the action that the board is asked to vote on tonight, it's being listed by the Office of Real Property Tax Services as a clerical error. I don't know how many $1.2 million clerical errors there are. I don't want to disparage those that work in a clerical world, but that's a pretty big clerical error.
Any further discussion?
We bear the brunt of it. I mean, we're seeing a decrease of 1.2. The library is about 29,000. Yeah, but this impact is going to impact the county and what they do. But
but their bills don't go out till January. They'll be corrected and squared away before their bills go out. It won't affect the county or the town at all.
Yeah,
because their correction will be corrected before their bills go out.
They'd have to base on corrected cash flow. They probably have.
Any further discussion? Cast your vote.
don't, like, just vote no, because you don't agree with it, because we kind of have to.
We're going to lose interest if we don't vote yet. I mean, we're going to lose money if we don't vote.
Form number four, tax correction. Just click on the white part. Motion has been carried 5-0. Moving on to number six. Old business. Is there any old business? New business. New business. Any other items? Okay, moving on to item number seven, recognition of district residents.
I have two questions I wanted to ask about.
Mark, can I ask you to please approach the podium? Yes.
Yes, I have two questions I want to ask about. The agenda that you have now is different than it has been in the past. It's a little bit more abbreviated, which doesn't allow the public or the media to understand, for instance, what we just voted on, the wording of what we just voted on. And I would like to just make the suggestion that you go back to including the second page that has those details that we used to have, like personnel and such as what you just voted on.
So what ultimately this new program will do for us is we will have it on the overhead. Am I still correct?
We're working towards that.
So it will basically be the agenda for us. The agenda is now digital. The goal is to have it digital here for you as well, so you will be able to see all of that information as we see it on our computers.
Can you project next?
Well, we're doing it as soon as possible, but the full detailed agenda can be printed from our website too. So
right.
We do provide the summary here, but it can be the full, I can show you how if you want, can be printed off of our website.
Right. I'm saying for people that don't come with it, you know, maybe they didn't go on the internet to look. Just in the interest of transparency, until you get that up and running, like you said.
Yeah, we will be more than happy to do that.
Okay.
Definitely.
The other question I had was a couple of weeks ago, we did a story about Highland did a review of poverty in their district, and I know Patricia testified and Michael, you testified. Is there a study that might be being done in Marlborough District to ascertain more clarity, because they did a very detailed study that is they're figuring out how to help their most vulnerable in the population.
We haven't done that study, but I'm sure that now that you've said that, Ms. Heck is going to reach out. We're looking at it from multi perspectives. It's not just about poverty. That's not our only area.
Exactly. And Highland was the same, but they did focus recently on that.
But that is what the work that's happening with Karen Brooks right now, looking at where are our not only our skill deficits, but which populations are having the most difficulty with specific skill sets.
Right.
So that's what's happening with our, how many days do we have with Ms. Brooks all year? Not a relation, by the way.
And what they found in Highland.
She'll be with us 10 days this year in all the buildings in total.
And what Highland found out, for instance, was they have 4 out of 10 students are falling in below the poverty level, which I think is 24,000 for a family of four, and they're below that.
Our percentage is about 37%. I think we heard the number today. So we're about 37% in the that would be designated as economically disadvantaged.
Right. Well, if you come out with that report, I think that would be helpful.
Absolutely.
Yeah, thanks.
Thank you.
Excuse me.
have a question.
Would you mind approaching the podium and just, if you would, just tell us your name and where you're from and address the board, please. Thank you.
My name is Susan Taylor, and I have a few questions about some of your services here. Two of my kids come here. One is Vanessa Alvarez, the other one is Skylar Harris. My daughter, Skylar Harris, is in special ed. She's been having a lot of behavioral problems lately, and I want to know what type of services you have for children like her. I don't seem like she's getting the services she needs.
I'd be remiss if I would speak specifically about any child tonight, so I would actually love to meet with you one-on-one.
Could we do that?
Absolutely.
Please.
Actually, Ms. Lurie at the end of the table is my secretary. She can set up an appointment.
Please. It's really important that.
But I would also encourage, have you met with the building principal yet? That would be a great starting point, but...
I'm on my way tomorrow, sure.
I'd be willing to meet with you at any time. Let's get our schedules together.
Please, we need to do that. It's important.
Absolutely. I'm more than happy to.
Okay, thank you.
Executive session. So if I can get a motion to adjourn, right? Second. Joanne, all in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed?